Good evening. Welcome, Inspire Church family, to this broadcast. As you know, this is not any ordinary week or any ordinary service. This is what we call the Passion Week, where Jesus is going to give his life on the cross. He's going to be buried, and then he's going to be resurrected. And that's why we are joining together in this very moment to celebrate the fact that Jesus did not remain in that tomb, for he is risen. We want to welcome you to Easter 2021 here at Inspire Church. This is the most important day of the year for us as Christians, as we remember what took place on this very day and time 2,000 years ago, because it changes everything. And so we want to just welcome you. Thank you so much for taking time to be with us. We know that you could be doing anything else. I pray that this broadcast would bless you. I know that our senior pastor, Dr. Hurd, is going to bring a powerful message. I know it's going to be powerful because the message of Easter, there is no more powerful message than the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So I want you to get your coffee ready, your pens, your notepads, get your family ready. Let's go into worship and let's celebrate the risen King. I'll see you soon.
You hear my defeated death, hell, and the grave. We will lift our eyes. We won't fear the fight. There is one who's stronger. Heart pressed on each side. We will
God for the victory. Somebody bless the Lord for the victory. Victory that is in his name. Victory that is in his blood. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, we are grateful that you are an awesome God. Awesome in everything that you do, oh God. That the battle is not ours, God, it belongs to you. The victory that we have, oh God, is not because of what we have done, but it is because of who you are. We stand here tonight, not in a place of defeat, but we stand in a place of victory because there is a name that is above any other name, that wonderful name, that powerful name of Jesus. Can somebody just bless the Lord for that name? Bless the Lord for that name. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you just for being God. Thank you, oh God, for giving us a place that we can come to, we can run to. A place where we can find refuge, a place where we can find safety. We thank you, oh God, that you are ever powerful. Your power is never diminishing, oh God. Malachi said you are God and you do not change. We thank you, oh God, that even in this moment, some have needs, oh God. Some have things that they have brought before you, God. We declare your sufficiency. We declare your ability. We declare that, God, somebody is being healed tonight as we pray. Somebody is being delivered as we pray. Somebody is receiving their breakthrough as we pray in the name of Jesus. They may not be in this place, but our God is not limited by time. Our God is not limited by geographical location. Our God is able. Our God is able. I will say it again. Our God is able. Our God is able. The Apostle Paul says to us, now unto him who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all we could ever ask or think. God has done great things. We are required to walk by faith and not by sight. Faith says my eyes don't see it, but my faith sees it because God has declared it. Can somebody just give God praise for healing that has gone over somebody, for deliverance? Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. You may be seated, and as you are sitting, please be mindful that you are indeed seated in heavenly places with your God. Man, it's so good to see your faces on a Saturday night service. Somebody say amen. It's the Black Saturday, they called it, but we know that there's victory coming. He is going to rise from the grave. Hallelujah, hallelujah. If we have anybody with us for the first time, maybe in person, and those that are joining us online, we thank you for choosing to worship with us this evening. We hope that you're not going to stay as a stranger. They are putting a QR code on the screen. You can just scan the QR code, or you can send the word guest to the number 713-360-1575. When you do that, they're going to send you a link where you can click on the link, complete the form so we get to know you and we can stay in touch. Somebody say amen. And this, let's just thank God for those that are here with us for the first time and those that are watching online for the first time. Somebody just thank God for them and for their lives. And that's how God adds people to the Inspire family. Thank you so much. And I just want to say, you know, God is faithful. God is faithful. I'm going to ask the ushers to come to give a tithing offering envelope. There are many ways we have been inspired to give, 5 ways. You can choose the way which is most convenient for you. As for me, my favorite one is text to give. It's my favorite one of the 5, text to give. And if I don't charge my phone, maybe I would do in person, but text to give is my favorite one. And I want to give you just a principle of giving that I found in Proverbs 11, verse number 24 to verse number 25 from the Passion Translation. It reads this way: generosity brings prosperity, but withholding from charity brings poverty. Those who live to bless others will have blessings heaped upon them, and the one who pours out his life to pour out blessings will be saturated with favor. If you are generous, there is prosperity coming. If you are one who is willing to bless others, there is going to be a heap of blessing coming your way. And if you pour out your life to be a blessing to others, you are going to be saturated with favor. Is anybody here who can just say, God, I need favor? Okay, maybe it's just me. I need favor. If you want the favor of God to be heaped upon you, just exercise your generosity and you are going to see what God is going to do. We're going to pray for your offering. Father, I just thank you that you are a faithful God. You give seed to the sower, bread to the eater. You are the one who causes the soul of those that are generous to be prosperous. Prosper your people in this season. Prosper your people in this day. May they live a life saturated with favor because God has taken a kind disposition towards them. God bless you. We love you. Amen.
Gonna hold my body Wow. Aren't you glad you came to church tonight? Amen. Easter only comes one time a year, but we celebrate it every day of our lives. And we experience the victory that it created for us to enjoy and embrace every day that we live. Amen. Jesus rose 2,000 years ago this weekend and forever changed the course of events of man's history. And we must never, ever forget that single fact. Because death is the single most powerful of all of the enemies that any one of us could ever face. And if Jesus took him out, there's not one thing you're facing here tonight that hasn't been solved by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Can somebody give the Lord some praise today? Amen. Amen. And good evening, Inspire. How are you? Amen. Happy Easter weekend, and God bless you. And you may be seated, and greeting also to our online audience. I'm so glad that you could join with us this evening. This is an incredible time, and the presence of the Lord is so real here in this place. I'm so glad that Jesus is risen and that the tomb is empty, aren't you? And because he lives, we can live also. Amen. Just before I get into my message, I want to say that the last two Wednesday nights have also just been incredible. Raul Cavazos taught on principles of personal finance. And if you were here, you will agree with me that it was amazing. This past Wednesday, he showed us how a couple making a combined income of $50,000 a year, that's husband and wife, and that's all they make, $50,000 a year, and never get a raise in their entire life, they can retire on $3.2 million if you follow the biblical principles that he taught just this past Wednesday night and the Wednesday night before. That is astonishing. And I'm not talking about him selling anything or you buying anything. And I'm not talking about a hot tip on some pump and dump stock out there on the market. All those tips that I've ever gotten, well, let me not even go there. I told Raul that he needs to label his teaching, Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? And the reason that I'm mentioning this is because those teachings are only up for 2 weeks. I want you to remember that. And those of you at home, if you haven't seen them yet, this coming Wednesday night, the first week will be taken down. And a week later, this past Wednesday night, will be taken down. And the reason for that is because Raul has invitations and places he's going to teach this material and use this material elsewhere. And he doesn't want all this stuff out there before he gets the chance to teach it. I know what that's like. Amen. I've had people write books on stuff that I've preached before, after hearing me before I could. And so, you know, what's worse is when they misquote you, and then you get blamed for their misquote. And so ask me if I've ever had that happen before. And so this Wednesday night, I want you to be aware that we're going back to church. And that's all in caps. And Wednesday nights matter at Inspire. And so briefly, if you want to turn with me to the Word of God, or they'll put it up on the screen, or if you want to find it on your devices, Luke chapter 23, verse 50 through 56. Now behold, there was a man named Joseph, a council member, a good and just man. He had not consented to their decision indeed. That was the decision by the Sanhedrin to crucify Christ, for he was from Arimathea, a city of the Jews, who himself was also waiting for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took it down, wrapped it in linen, and laid it in a tomb that was hewn out of the rock where no one had ever lain before. That day was the preparation, and the Sabbath drew near. And the women who had come with him from Galilee followed after, and they observed the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and fragrant oils, and they rested on the Sabbath according to the commandment. Luke 24, verse 1 through 3. Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb bringing the spices which they had prepared Friday afternoon before Jesus died and was taken down from the cross and put in a borrowed tomb for the observance of the 6 p.m. Sabbath beginning. The Bible says, but they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Then they went in, and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. They then went back to the disciples to tell them what had occurred. My message today is going for a funeral, but attending a resurrection. Father, I thank you so much for what Easter means. I thank you for the sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ, but I'm so glad that death could not hold him down because all of our hope was tied up in his resurrection. And thank you for raising him from the dead. Thank you for the sacrifice that Jesus paid for our sins, the suffering, the humiliation, the shame, the agony, and all that he went through. We are forever indebted to you, Lord. Thank you for loving us so much. In Jesus' name. And everybody shouted and said, amen. Amen. When families go through loss, and that's something we are all familiar with, the church is supposed to be there for them. People depend upon a church during times of bereavement, don't they? We certainly have done our share of funerals over the years, both at the Legacy Building and even at this location. I remember the first time I did 4 funerals in one day and wondered how I could keep that pace. And that was at the old building before there was ever a disease called COVID that had affected our earth and before there was a pandemic. Churches expect their ministers to be there. They expect to be served in times of death, and they have a right to. We've done 14 funerals over just a 2-week period recently in this very place or connected with this church as people have lost their lives, many of them from COVID. So I don't think that you could go anywhere in the world right now and not find people who are not intimately acquainted with death being very close to them, very near to them. I keep saying, I thank God we've never had an outbreak at this church, and we haven't. But on the periphery, we've had people connected to us that have lost their lives, even some in the church. We know what it's like to suffer loss. Our text begins after the crucifixion of Jesus is over. It ended on a Friday afternoon. Jesus died. The Sabbath was about to begin. You see, the Jewish people count the hours of a day a little bit differently than the rest of the world does. Their day begins at 6 in the evening, not at midnight like ours always begins. That's based upon the scriptures and the Genesis account of creation, Genesis chapter 1. Verse 5, in a number of other places, it says this, and God called the light day and the darkness he called night. But this is the phrase I want you to see. So the evening and the morning were the first day. In God's economy, things always begin at their darkest and move toward their brightest. And God set up his day that way. The Jewish law forbade them from burying anyone on the Sabbath. And so that meant that they had to hurry and take the body of Jesus down from the cross and get him into a grave before the Sabbath began at 6 p.m. He had died at 3 o'clock that afternoon. They had crucified him at 9 in the morning. And for 6 hours, he had gone through unbearable agony on the cross. Every time he breathed, he had to chin himself up because the pull of his weight against the nails hanging from the cross would not allow him to expand his lungs to breathe. So he would push with his feet against the nail in his feet that had nailed him to the cross, and then chin himself up, as it were, with the nails in his hands, and take a breath and sink back down to exhale it again. They barely had time to wrap Jesus in a burial cloth after he died at 3 p.m. that afternoon, before the 6 o'clock hour came. And that's one of the reasons that they hurriedly found the borrowed tomb that they placed Jesus in, that was owned by Joseph of Arimathea, that he had actually hewn for himself. Their intention, the disciples' plan, to return after the Sabbath was over and do a proper interment or burial or funeral, we would call it, for the body of Jesus. But how many of you know that things don't always turn out the way that you plan for them to turn out? Amen. Things can turn out differently than you expected. So Jesus had been in the tomb since Friday afternoon all the way to the turn of the calendar into Saturday at 6 p.m., all the way through Saturday, all the way through the turn of the calendar again, Saturday evening at 6 p.m., and now the sun was coming up in the east on Sunday morning when the women went to anoint the body of Jesus for his final interment. You see, it was the responsibility of the women in their culture to prepare the body for its final rest. And the women disciples got there early, fully intending, because they had brought the spices with them, to anoint his body, and then there would be closure, final closure of the tomb. It had been a violation. It would have been a violation, I should say, of the Sabbath law to have returned the day after he was buried. So literally, Jesus had been in the tomb for those 3 days. And when they arrived at the tomb that was owned by Joseph of Arimathea, they were stunned to find the massive stone had been rolled away that was used to seal the tomb. And this was just not what they expected to find. They didn't know what to make of it. So they quickly turned around and ran back to where the disciples, the men disciples, were at, the male disciples, and they told them what they had found. And Peter and John ran ahead of everybody else and ran to the tomb to see what was going on. They just were stunned by the story that had been related to them of the ladies that had gotten there earlier. And they too were surprised when they arrived. They encountered an angel. You see, this was the day that they had planned to do the funeral, but the angel showed up and said, "You came here looking for a funeral, but why are you looking for the living among the dead? There's not going to be a funeral today. There's been a resurrection." The body of Jesus was not there. You see, surprises can have far-reaching consequences that you were not expecting. All of us have learned that through the years. We've lived long enough to know that. Never will forget a friend of mine pastored in the state of Louisiana. His name was Ray Johnson. He and I were enjoying fellowship with a family in his church and the church he served. And the man was telling us a story about unexpected consequences, and you couldn't help but laugh. He had been raised on a farm out in the country, and they owned animals, and they had a big chicken house and hen house, and they had gone to bed one night, and while they were asleep, Old Blue, their hound dog, who was so old he couldn't hardly smell or see, or here for that matter, began to let out a big noise and began to howl, and the chickens in the hen house began to make all this commotion, and they knew immediately that a fox had gotten into the hen house. And that old house was cold, and he was telling the story that his dad always wore during the winter Long John underwear. Y'all remember what those were? And they had a button on each side in the back, and one of the buttons had come off and the flap was hanging open. And his dad jumped out of bed and got up, grabbed his shotgun, wasn't worried about trying to hold that flap, and went outside and started creeping up to the hen house with that shotgun and both hammers pulled back, and old Blue got in right behind him, the dog did. And the old man got close to the hen house and he stopped, waiting for his eyes to adjust to the light. And as luck would have it, or bad luck would have it, old Blue didn't seem, and his cold nose touched that man right where that flap was hanging open. And the guy was telling us, said it wasn't so funny after we got through cleaning chickens for 2 days, because he let go with both barrels of that shotgun and killed nearly every chicken in the place. You can live through things that have unexpected consequences. And I want to tell you that the consequences of the resurrection are still being felt to the very day that we live right now. The far-reaching consequences of Jesus coming out of that tomb are astonishing. I want to make several salient observations about what happened that Sunday morning. The first observation is this: clearly, on that Easter morning, there was a problem. There was a problem, but the problem wasn't what they thought it was, and it wasn't that the tomb was empty either, or that the body had disappeared. They thought that was the problem, but that wasn't the problem. The problem wasn't that Jesus was not there. The problem wasn't even that Jesus had risen from the dead. That's the good thing that happened. The problem was they had gone there in the first place preparing for a funeral. They were carrying spices with which to put Jesus to rest, they thought, for his final time. And after 3.5 years, Christ had been teaching them all during that period, remember, that this was going to happen, that he would rise again. After 3.5 years, you would think that it would have sunk in. I mean, hadn't he taught them in Matthew 21:38 that the kingdom of heaven was like a vineyard owner that sent his son looking to receive what his tenants owed him on the vineyard he had leased out to them, and they killed him? Didn't Jesus tell them that parable? And in Caesarea Philippi, Mark's gospel records that the kingdom was like a man who sent his son to collect. Jesus told his disciples that he would be betrayed in Caesarea Philippi, and that he would be delivered to the high priest and be killed, but that he would rise again on the third day. And then again in John 2, Jesus had even told the disciples that if they were to tear down the temple of his body, that in 3 days he would raise it again. You would think that this would have gotten through to them. And how about Matthew chapter 20, verse 18 through 19. Jesus had told his disciples plainly, and I read, "Behold, we're going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests and to the scribes, and they will condemn him to death and deliver him to the Gentiles to mock and to scourge and to crucify, and the third day he will rise again." They should have known. He told them enough times. Clearly, he told them what was about to happen. They should not have been surprised. It seems that when it did take place, they were so intent and focused on having a funeral that they forgot all about the resurrection part of what he had said. Oh, they got it that he would be betrayed. They got it that he would be scourged. They got it that he would be crucified. They got it that he would be buried. Why didn't it sink in that he would be resurrected? And how many of us find ourselves from time to time in the very same situation the disciples were in? And what do I mean? I mean, when things get tough, we start preparing for a funeral, when we ought to be looking for a resurrection because of Easter. Things get tough. You know what we do? We start wondering how the sad ending's going to turn out. We wonder, do we have enough Kleenex on hand? We wonder if we're going to survive it. We wonder how we're going to make it through it. And what we ought to be doing because of Easter is celebrating the fact that there is going to be a resurrection possible for us also. And I'm not just talking about when we die, but there's a resurrection possible in our lives. For every difficult event that we face in the course of our lives, the story of the resurrection is one of hope in times of hopelessness and encouragement in times of despair. Now, to be sure, they had reasons to be looking for a funeral. I mean, at the time of Jesus' crucifixion, they simply were not able, I guess, to wrap their minds around the horrific scene that unfolded before them. I mean, he had said he would come back, but really, the violence of what they were seeing was so graphic, so vivid, so deeply seared into their minds that nobody could come back from that. Surely not. They had watched him beaten and scourged, an act that lacerated his skin and ripped open his flesh, and his body was raw like hamburger meat. History says that whenever they took him from Pilate's judgment hall to walk toward Golgotha, every place he put his foot left an imprint of blood. They called it the Via Dolorosa. I've walked it many times in Jerusalem. It means the way of suffering. It's still there. Everywhere he put his foot, a bloody footprint. They had witnessed Jesus be nailed to the cross. That's about as inhumane as anything you could ever see in your lifetime. Feet placed together, a spike like a railroad spike driven through them. Spikes into his hands. And then the crowd is the crowd becomes silent for a moment as somebody kicks the bottom of the cross after they've lifted it up and moves it over a few inches, and it drops with a thud into the hole they prepared for it in the ground. That's tough. They had been there and watched Jesus do this thing where he had to chin himself up to breathe and let himself down to die. They had watched all of that. They had been close enough to hear him cry, "It is finished." And those who were there and who heard him knew it was really done. It was over. God can't come back from something like that. The conclusion of his life was so emphatic that it left no room for a new beginning, is the point that I'm making. And you see, death is the one challenge that in spite of all of man's accomplishments and achievements, you notice they haven't been able to fix yet. You notice that? I mean, we can soar across the heavens and we can put a man on the moon and we can plunge into the depths of the ocean in a bathysphere, and we can literally go to the Marianas Trench, which is the deepest part of the ocean. We can do many things. We can climb Mount Everest. We've cured diseases man has that they once thought incurable. But the one thing we're not so good at is when somebody dies, bringing them back again. And there is that solemn weight of history that lets us know that death is so completely final, and we've learned to accept death. The problem is, we've learned to accept it in a lot of different ways, for a lot of different things. We've accepted it for our marriage when a marriage fails. We accept it for our finances when that goes wrong. We accept it for a career or for a business, and when something dies, we just accept the fact it's over. And perhaps we shouldn't give up so soon. Maybe we ought to hold on just a little bit longer. And as believers, certainly the disciples should have been preparing for the resurrection, shouldn't they? And that's because Jesus had told them that he was coming back, as I just stated a while ago. Jesus, the living Word of God, had foretold it. And anytime God tells you something, you can mark it down. You can take it to the bank. Oh, somebody in the building ought to shout, amen. But his resurrection caught them by surprise. You see, that's because we sometimes allow our situation and circumstances to become more real to us than what God has spoken over us is real. And you should never let anything in your life be more real to you than the word that God has spoken over your life. Somebody in the building said hallelujah right now. Christ had expected them to believe. He was counting on them to believe. He was looking for them to believe. How do I know that? Because after the resurrection, Christ appeared on the road to Emmaus to two of his disciples in Luke 24 and in verse 25. Then he said to them, "O foolish ones," they were debating what had happened in Jerusalem, and the body of Jesus after being crucified was now no longer there. And they were so upset about that. They didn't know what it meant. And they were telling each other that, you know, Jesus not only, you know, disappeared from the tomb, but some of the ladies have said that they went there and saw angels, and one of them said she saw him, and another of his disciples went there and said he saw an angel too when he went into the tomb, and that the angel had said that he was not there, that he was risen, and Jesus joined them, and his appearance was shielded and hidden from them. And this is what he said, "O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe in all the prophets have spoken, ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory?" And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. He was disappointed, it seems, that they had not taken him at his word. And one of the most important questions that you can ask yourself on Easter is this: why was Jesus resurrected? Why? We know he came to pay our debt and to die in our place. But why was he resurrected? To pay our debt required that he die, because without shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins. That's what the Bible had said. And had he only died, that would have been part of it, right? But you see, for him to only die would have left us powerless to deal with the life that followed for us. Even though our debt had been paid, we would have been powerless to live without sin dominating our lives every moment, every minute, every hour, every day, every month, every year that we lived. Jesus was resurrected that we might have newness of life. But that's not all. Christ was resurrected to show the enemy that he was defeated for all time, once and for all. It's over, finished, Satan. You are defeated. You see, when Jesus died, the Bible tells us that he descended past the very gates of hell and went straight up to the enemy and wrenched off of his belt the keys of death, hell, and the grave. He conquered not only death, but he conquered hell. But there's still yet another reason that Jesus rose. Christ rose, and his resurrection was meant to show us that nothing, absolutely nothing, are you hearing me? Nothing is so far beyond help that it's beyond the reach of God. Nothing. Nothing. His arm is not short that it cannot save, and his ear is not heavy that he cannot hear. And I'm talking to somebody maybe at home right now, but you feel like your situation is hopeless. It is not. The resurrection proves it is not. Oh, bless his name forever. Hallelujah. Christ wasn't just a man. He was also equally and fully God. He wanted to show us that not even death is final. no matter what form it is in. Whether it's a coffin with a body lying in it that we grieve over, or it's a divorce decree that makes you think your life has ended, or it's a loss of a career or a job or downsizing in the marketplace, Jesus wanted you to know it's not over as long as you'll just trust him. It's not over at all. I won't tell you a story, and some of you are not going to quite know how to take this, but that's okay. About 3 weeks ago, I guess it'll be a month tomorrow, I buried one of my ministry sons. His name is Kent Brown. Some of you knew him. Kent pastored in Liberty up past Crosby. And he was a real son in ministry to me. We were very close. His wife, Penny, is an incredible lady, and they were an amazing couple. They love God. Kent's email address was worshipmanbrown. If that tells you anything about his heart. Worshipmanbrown. They serve people. Kent contracted COVID. I was overseas when I heard about it, and I called, we talked, communicated by text, and as soon as I got back in the country, I sent a text to him, "How you feeling?" And I'd heard he had gone to the hospital. I can't go up there. I actually tried to call him. He didn't answer the phone, so I sent a text, and he responded back after a little while and told me that he wasn't doing real well. And so that began a process where we text back and forth for several days, and then all of a sudden he wasn't responding to my text anymore, and was talking to Penny and discovered that they had put him in a medically induced coma, put him on a ventilator. He'd been in ICU the whole time. Man, I went into intercession the moment I first heard he was sick. I was overseas and went into intercession. I was so burdened for him that for weeks, every night I was waking up 4, 5, 6 times a night to pray for Kent. His condition didn't get any better. His oxygen sat levels just kept dropping, and a lot of people interceding for Kent. Penny, his wife, the last week before Kent went home to be with the Lord, she started telling me, she was weeping on the phone when she said it. She said, "Pastor, I don't want Kent to see something over there that's so wonderful that he doesn't want to come back." And man, I thought about that. You see, science doesn't know how to explain consciousness. Are you aware of that? That for all they have been able to do, they cannot tell you what causes the spark of life to be in you. They cannot explain what consciousness is or is not. Continued to pray for him. He had been in the hospital at this point, I think about 6 weeks. And on Saturday morning at 5:00, I was awakened, and this is what you're going to think is kind of strange, and it's okay with me if you do, because you may have some stories like this too. But I woke up at 5 a.m. to pray for him, and I sensed him standing there, and I sleep on the left side of the bed, and I was on my left side, and I turned over, and he was there, and I could see his luminous features. Didn't think about it at the time, but it meant that he was literally kind of hovering over the bed. And you're going to think, oh boy, this is one of those weird stories. Call it what you want to. And without moving his mouth, he spoke to me, and I heard him say, "It's okay, Dad, I'm okay. It's all right, Dad." That's what he called me, his dad. I was so upset when that happened. I was so upset. Because I didn't get the vibe that he was going to be healed in that experience. And I'd been wrestling in prayer that he would. And the next morning, that was on Saturday morning at 5:00. The next morning we had church here, and Pastor Robert Pace, who is the mystic on our staff, and also Steve Miller, another one of our pastors, were in the office, and I'd already told Andrew about it, what had happened. And Steve and Robert came by the office, and I said, guys, I want to tell you something. I want you to think I'm weird. I'm not going to weird you out here. I explained to them what happened, and I said, tell me what this means, because I'm worried. I'm concerned I'm going to lose Ken. I'm worried about the implications of this. And they couldn't tell me. And I realized that a psychologist would have some explanation like this, that I willed it because of my deep-rooted conviction in faith and life after death. I know all of that. And I know that a counselor would say that it was probably a coping mechanism at work because of my deep distress because of Ken's condition, and that I was basically reassuring myself that everything would be all right in spite of what was happening. And I also realized that a scientist would say it was just a dream caused by the firing of random neurons. I know that a theologian would say it was my inner being trying to express meaning. But I knew it was more than any of those things. The Bible says we're compassed about with a great cloud of witnesses. That's Hebrews chapter 12. Look it up sometime. And it was talking about people that had gone on to be with the Lord. And you might not know this, but Jewish people say that even at death, that the spirit stays near the body from anywhere from 3 to 7 days. And boy, I mean, I was so stressed out. I couldn't tell Penny. I didn't want to hurt her faith. That's Kent's wife. So I called her and I said, Penny, I'm supposed to go overseas and I'm really wrestling about whether I should leave today or not. And she said, Pastor, you get on that plane. You go ahead and Kent's going to be fine. We believe in God. And she said, God can hear your prayers over there from Africa just like you can here. And she said, not only that, Pastor, but we can't even get into the hospital to see him anyway. So you go ahead and go. And I didn't tell her. And I got on the plane and I left and I got to Africa on Monday evening. And the next morning, Kent went home to be with the Lord. I immediately had to turn around and go get COVID tested and all kind of stuff and change my ticket and turned around and came back. And I preached his funeral that following Sunday in Liberty. And the building, I guess maybe the biggest church building in Liberty, it was filled, jam-packed. Some of you might have even been there. There were folks standing around the walls. There were people out in the lobby. There were folk in the Family Life Center. Steve Miller went over with me, and I went over and preached his funeral and just shared this story that I just shared, but there's another part to it that I won't tell you about. And then the funeral ended with three of his ministry sons leading in worship. They sang three songs. And finally, 15 minutes after I finished preaching and they finished singing, I went and stood by the coffin like a minister does, and everybody in that place had to come by and greet the family, and it took the longest. And I didn't mind. That's not what I'm saying. Didn't mind at all. I was standing there. Ministers were there, pastors were there, spoke with them. When the last person came by, I greeted the family. And then I slipped out and found the pastor of the church building that had let us use his building for the service because Ken's wasn't big enough. And then I went and got my car. Now here's my point. My iPhone was in my back pocket the whole time. And I had on a mask, except for the time that I was on the platform. It was at least probably an hour by the time I got in my car. There were two deputies' vehicles in front of me, and so I backed up. Before I did, let me tell you what happened. I walked to the car, my phone in my back pocket, mask still on, took my coat off, hung it up in the back seat, right? And backed up, pulled around the vehicles, took my mask off, set my mask down, drove out, took a left, went to the block, took another left, went a block, took another left, and went back to the main drag, there in Liberty. If you know Liberty, you probably know what I'm talking about. And I'm sitting there. Now, I should tell you this, that while I'm waiting for traffic to go by, my iPhone was still in my back pocket. My iPhone doesn't know me if I have a mask on. It's got facial recognition software, but it doesn't recognize me because I haven't set it up to identify me with a mask. And I'm sitting there and a song begins to play on my iPhone. And there's a unique feature about an iPhone, especially one with facial recognition software, because if you touch the screen with your hand and it sees your face, maybe even at an angle, you're walking with it like this, it can open your iPhone. And if your thumb happens to be on the library app where you keep your tunes, it can play the last song you've played from your selection. I know what the last song I played was. I was sitting in Africa. Kent was a guitarist. And the fact that I got word that he had passed away reminded me of another blues guitarist named Landon Spradlin, who was a Hall of Fame inductee, a blues Hall of Famer, great guitarist. He became a pastor, and he died of COVID. He'd been to New Orleans for Mardi Gras outreach last year and was on his way back home. Got as far as North Carolina. I think he lived in Virginia. And he became sick and they had to put him in the hospital and he never made it home. So I was listening to his song. And that was the last song I listened to. And if my iPhone had played any song, it should have been that one. But I'm sitting there at that corner. And I'm thinking, Kent and I had a song that we had laughed about together. There was a pastor named Randy Bowerman. Some of you might have known Randy. He was our friend. Randy died. Stomach cancer, bowel cancer. He beat it, I think, three times. Fourth time it got him. And I went up to Dallas to go to his funeral, and Kent and Penny were there. And you'll never guess what song they played at the end of Randy's funeral. He set it up this way himself. You know what the song was? The song that he had play was one by Leanne Womack entitled, I Hope You'll Dance. And the reason he had that song played there, it's a song that has a strong faith under current, as it were, throughout the song. But the reason he had them play that song, he was telling his family and his friends and everybody there, don't let this be the end. I know it's sad and all of that, but if you get a chance, dance, man. Go ahead with life. And I won't show you this because you're going to find this crazy. I love music. I have 6,898 songs on my phone. You know anybody else that has that many? That's a screenshot from my information page. And I'm sitting there waiting to turn out, and all of a sudden my phone in my back pocket starts playing a song, but it's not Landon Spradlin's song. It's this one right here.
I hope you never lose your sense of wonder. You get your fill to eat, but always keep that hunger. May you never take one single breath for granted.
My phone in my back pocket started playing the song that Kent and I laughed about when they finished Randy Bowerman's funeral. The song he and I had in common that we had said, man, that was good of Randy to think about that. Care enough about his family and friends that he wanted to let them know, guys, I've got to go, but there's still reason for you to laugh. Man, I pulled my phone out of my pocket and the screen was still dark. It hadn't even been unlocked. It just started playing by itself. This is at least an hour after the funeral is over. If it played anything, it should have played the song that I played last in Africa. But it selected one out of 6,898 songs. I can show you my phone. It's in my office. The odds are virtually impossible that that would have happened. Now you say, what do you think that means, Pastor? Like I said, some of you, it might be beyond your ability to grasp it. I'll tell you what I think it means. I think it was God letting me know that just because I had lost somebody dear to me didn't mean it was over yet. And that I still had reason to look forward to the future. And you know what I really believe? That if you could find a song that would fit what was happening on resurrection morning, I believe it would have been before the women got there. This would have been the music playing in the background. I hope you'll dance because it's not the end just because Jesus was put in a tomb. It's not the end. He's coming up out of there. I hope you'll dance. I hope you realize this is not over yet. I hope you realize there's still hope. And that's what I've come to tell you, that as long as there is an empty tomb, there is hope. Your situation is not beyond the help of God Almighty. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost in this building. We should believe in the resurrection. And here's why. Number one, God foretold it in his word. Number two, because God has the power to do what men think is impossible. And number three, we should believe in the resurrection because the evidence points to it. You call all of that coincidence all day long, and I'm going to just smile and nod my head and say, yeah. But I know better. I know better. I've never had an incident like that happen in my life, not even once. And to have two connected with the same funeral has left me profoundly moved. When I say the evidence points to it, it's because the empty tomb, the saints that got out of the graves, did you get that? The saints that got out of their tombs and walked around the streets of Jerusalem, the pagan Roman centurion who said, that man was the Son of God. Truly he was. And the disciples who were transformed from weak, fearful men into bold, courageous lions for truth. All of that points to the resurrection. Something changed them. But that's not the only evidence. There's evidence all over this room that Jesus rose from the dead. Because every one of you whose lives have been saved and transformed are living proof that he conquered death, hell, and the grave. Somebody shout and say hallelujah. Somebody shout and say hallelujah. You are living proof that Jesus is alive. And if you're here, you're watching at home, and you don't know what I'm talking about, how do you personally experience the power of resurrection in your life? Or if you know God, but you're facing an impossible situation, You say, Pastor, how do I experience resurrection power in my life? The disciples learned something about the resurrection from Jesus, and it didn't start on Easter morning. No. Peter learned something whenever he watched Jesus go in and raise Jairus' daughter from the dead. In Acts 9, he had a chance to apply what he learned when Dorcas, the godly widow, and Joppa passed away. And they sent and they brought Peter there and told him, this lady is too good to let go of. She's too good to release into eternity. We need her. She's helped so many people. And in Acts 9, verse 36 and 38, at Joppa, there was a certain woman named Tabitha, which is translated Dorcas. The woman was full of good works and charitable deeds, which she did. But it happened in those days that she became sick and died. And when they had washed her, they laid her in an upper room. And since Lydia was near Joppa and the disciples had heard that Peter was there in Lydia, they sent two men to him, imploring him to not delay in coming to them. I won't tell you how you can have resurrection. And if you're watching at home, how you can resurrect some things in your life. Notice the first thing Peter did when he got there, the Bible said he went into that upper room. You will never conquer your problem by running from it as long as you live. If you run, that problem will be breathing down your neck. It will be following down behind you. It will be chasing after you. But if you ever stop and turn around and say to that problem, I'm done running, you can put a stop to it. Yes, you can. And Peter went into an upper room. And sometimes you know what you got to do? You just got to get above street level. You got to rise to another place. There is a place where heaven overlaps earth's dimension, and that is in worship. And if you can get into that overlap between earth and heaven, I'm telling you, if you can find an upper room somewhere, if you can cause your problem to let go of your ankles long enough to reach up and touch God, God can resurrect some things in your life. God can raise some things that are beyond hope. Peter went into that upper room. Next thing he did, and I'm done, Peter put everyone out of the room that he could resurrect Dorcas. And you do know that's what you got to do too. You got to shut out some voices in your life. You got to get rid of some people that are hangers-on, that are steering you in the wrong direction. Hello, somebody. Because there's somebody might be talking you out of a miracle. Somebody might be keeping you from experiencing the power of a resurrected life and other aspects of your existence. And you can't let anybody rob you of what God has in store for you. You can't do it. You got to tell some people to be quiet. You got to tell some folk, I'm not listening to you. Talk to the hand here. Not listening to you. I need a miracle too bad to listen to you. I need to touch God too bad to listen to you. I need to be in the house of God too bad to listen to your criticism and your griping and your negativism. Hello, somebody. I got to get a hold of the Lord. I got to get a hold of God. So I don't know how long I'm going to be alive in this world, and I need resurrection power to be inside of my body. He put everybody out of the room. And then also notice that he prayed. And he didn't depend on his ability to pray when he prayed. He depended upon the ability of God to answer prayer. You don't even need to know how to pray. All you have to do is just know how to say Jesus. Jesus. That's all you need to know how to do is in your moment of distress, say Jesus. They didn't pray all these fancy prayers in times of dire need in the Bible anyway. We write all of these lovely floral prayers out, and we want to sound eloquent. And sometimes God listens to that stuff and said, can you get a load of this guy down here? Tells Gabriel, listen, that's a prayer? No. And some little lady without an education, or a man without an education in desperate circumstances, doesn't know what to do other than to just say Jesus. And God says, I can answer that prayer right there. That's a prayer. I mean, that's coming from the heart. Amen. Amen. He prayed and Dorcas rose from the dead. I conclude by telling you that the message of Easter is this. Don't let some hell-bent heart make you bitter. Give heaven more than just a passing glance. Still feel small when you stand at the ocean. Don't fear the mountains in the distance. And if you get a chance to sit it out or dance, dance. Live your life for God. Make a mark with your life. Would you stand with me across the building right now? Every head bowed. If you're at home, talking to you as well. If there's somebody here that needs God in their life, you don't have him, would you just slip up your hand and say, I need God, Pastor. I need God. Need God. God bless you. I see your hand. God bless you. God bless you, dear lady. I see your hand also. God bless you. Sitting in your living room, if you need Christ in your life, just slip up your hand and say, Pastor, I need Jesus. And if there's somebody in this building that needs the power of resurrection to work in some area of their life, I don't know what that might be. Or would you slip up your hand and say, pray for me, Pastor. I need resurrection life in my finances, my marriage. I need resurrection life, my health. God bless the hands. Lord Jesus, I pray that those who raise their hands that need salvation, that you would save them right now. What a wonderful time for someone to give their heart to the Lord. Write their name in the book of life. We thank you, Lord Jesus, because death could not hold you down. And because you live, we can live. And I pray for every person that is here that needs to experience resurrection in some part of their life, whether that's their marriage or relationships, whether it's a father and a son, a mother and a daughter, whether it's a career, a business, somebody's health. I ask you to work, Lord Jesus, and do what you specialize in. Bring resurrection life. I ask in Jesus' name. And everybody said, in Jesus' name, would you do it? Shout it out loud, in Jesus' name. If you prayed with us just a moment ago, they're going to put a QR code on the screen. If you would go there, let us know. We would be so delighted to hear from you. You need salvation, let us know. You need baptism, let us know. You need prayer for an area of your life, let us know. And do be baptized and go on and be filled with the Holy Spirit. We welcome you into the body of Christ. Thank you for taking your first steps. We rejoice with you. We would love for you to be a part of our church family, because to grow in Christ, you need to be connected to a strong church family. And so they're going to put another, there it is, join. If you will text join to that number right there, or capture the QR code, we would love to have you connect with us. I write a daily devotional that is sent out every day, and the whole church goes to the foot of the cross together every day. And we'd love to have you be a part of that. If you don't have a home church, we'd love to have you here. God bless you. I want to close the service the way that I've closed Easter services for many years. In Russia, I will never forget going there right after the Iron Curtain fell. The only church that was allowed all those years was the Russian Orthodox Church. And they close every Easter service in Russia the same way. The pastor stands and shouts, "Christ is risen." And all of the people shout together, "He is risen indeed." Would you join with me in doing that? Christ is risen. God bless you in Jesus' name. I love you so much. Thank you for coming tonight.
Wow, wow, what a service. I know you can feel it at home, because we certainly feel it here. The presence of the Lord is so strong here. Because of the message of Easter is still as powerful as it was 2,000 years ago. That same power that raised Christ from the dead is present here. And we just want to encourage those who receive the Lord for the first time. We're so excited that you accepted Jesus, and we're so excited to go on this journey with you. If you need to request baptism or further prayer, or you want someone to walk you through what's next, please comment below. We have people who are standing by right now who want to pray with you. Get you all the resources and all the information you need. But listen, we want to thank you so much for taking the time to join us in this broadcast for this Easter service. We pray that you were blessed by the word of the Lord. We pray that you would experience the power of the resurrection now, the resurrection power working in your life now and every day of the year. We love you so much, Inspire Church. We'll see you soon.